John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my backyard desert garden here. And today it's over 100 degrees like it has been for most of the summer here. And in this video, what I want to do for you guys is actually give you guys a pepper update. You know, as you guys know, the pepper bed on this side, for those of you guys that have been watching me a while, I actually use this space-age material. You guys probably can't see it. It's all the way down here. But basically, it's normally used for insulation of your attic. You know, to keep it cool. It's basically a radiant barrier reflective material that, you know, people use a similar material for actually just doing plastic mulch. I actually carefully cut out holes and planted my plants in there. And now what I wanted to do for you guys is actually show you the comparison between actually the ones planted with the plastic mulch, which actually the main benefit is maybe some sun reflection, but, you know, probably more so the thing that's important is keeping the ground covered and keeping the ground more moist underneath there compared to another pepper bed that I planted out several weeks, maybe even a month earlier, and like the growth and production in each bed. And it looks like to me that overall, the side that I did the plastic mulch on has kind of caught up to this side, although the production hasn't quite caught up yet, but the plants are actually growing quite tall and they're pretty healthy. But before I get into that, and then also what I want to do in this episode is actually show you some other places where I planted peppers. I have over 300 pepper plants planted this season in my garden. Like, I don't know, maybe 60 there, 80, 60 or 80 there, 60 or 80 here. And then I have like several raised beds full of peppers, and then two more raised beds actually in the back. So I'm pepper rich. But before I get into showing you guys all the peppers I'm growing and how they're doing in different situations, some are under you know, shade, some are in full sun, some are on subsoil irrigation systems, some are on drip, some are in different kind of soil mixtures. I want to actually teach you guys about harvesting the peppers. This is one of the most important things to me. I've explained this in previous episodes, and I want to explain to you guys why I never harvest any green peppers to eat. And you will definitely want to know this information. I mean, especially if you guys are gardening and have the choice to pick your peppers green or wait until they actually ripen up and turn red, orange, or yellow. So now I'm about to harvest some of my peppers, and one of my best performing plants this year has been this guy. It's the Bonnie Mild Jalapeno. I did buy this at Home Depot. That being said, I like to grow a small percentage of Bonnie plants every year in my garden because there's new and different varieties that I may not be able to get anywhere else. And I always like to experiment. If a certain variety that I find that I grow that I like, I might either A, save the seeds, or B, source the seeds somewhere else and then grow them in following years, right? Other than that, most of my plants come from a local nursery, family owned, that I like to support, where generally I get higher quality, better plants. That being said, sometimes the Bonnie plants that I buy are a little bit more further along, you know, than some of the plants that I buy in jumbo six packs, which is how I get most of my plants since the cost per plant is actually relatively inexpensive. You know, I did post an Instagram post, and I would encourage you guys to check out my Instagram. I'll put a link to the description where I try to post on a daily basis cool pictures of things that I'm eating, plants that are growing in my garden, cool things going on in my life, so you guys could see that. But anyways, I posted a picture of this bountiful pepper plant and how I've gotten a lot of peppers off it, and how it's actually a Bonnie plant. And somebody commented, "You're supporting Monsanto when you're buying a Bonnie plant," all right? And so, like, here's the thing, right? I have many different thoughts. You know, there's many different pros and cons in the world, and in our society, we're taught to think right, wrong, good, bad, right? And you know, things are a lot more complex to me, and I try to look at things with like a broader scope and be more kind of divergent instead of convergent, right? Convergent is like, Bonnie's bad because they're connected with Monsanto in some ways, and I'm never gonna support them. But for me personally, you know, I have opinions about Bonnie plants, and in general, I think I'm glad that Bonnie plants is around, that they're in business, that they've been growing plants for Americans that really can't get plants in other places. Like, they're available at Home Depot, Lowe's, Walmart, and other local nurseries near you. I do feel that they are probably a little bit overpriced and expensive for what you get. They do not grow GMOs. That being said, recently, last couple of years, Scott's Miracle-Gro invested you know, some amount of money in Bonnie plants, whether they're co-owners or part owners, you know, whatever. And then people think like Scotts, it's owned by Monsanto. So Scotts and Monsanto, they're two different companies. And although, you know, they're partners, Scotts and Monsanto, so they do business dealings to sell the Roundup, which I do not agree with, or other, synthetic chemicals, either pesticides, herbicides, or fertilizers that Scotts grow. You know, they don't own Bonnie. They might own a portion of them. But nonetheless, Bonnie plants allow people across the United States to grow plants by buying pretty much healthy plant starts. Now, they don't use GMO. That being said, they did come out with an organic line this year, which I'm quite happy about. That being said, something I'm also not happy about is that they do not disclose, you know, the different kind of sprays they spray on their plants, because I've asked them and it's like proprietary. You know, that being said, they are approved for food use. But that being said, I always encourage you guys to do the best you can. The best I can is buy a lot of plants from other places, but sometimes I want to experiment and I really want to try this mild jalapeno. And to my amazement, it's grown really well. And you guys can see it's, pushing 3 feet tall. And look at all these peppers on here, right? We got all these red ones that are quite ripe. And then if you look really closely, kind of blending in, we got all these green ones. I don't know if you guys can see that. Here's a green one here, green one here, green one here, green one here. And a whole bunch of green ones and ones currently flowering. So I'll have a whole bunch of green ones later. Now I know there's many different people on YouTube, you know, promoting, hey, you know, pick your peppers early when they're still green. I probably got some green ones in the background. Maybe there's one here out of the camera can't see. I know probably a couple over here, you guys can't see. And if you pick them early, then you could get a second flush or a third flush. And that way you're gonna have two times or three times more peppers if you pick them early. Because if you let them ripen up, you know, the plants are not gonna produce as much, right? And so my opinion on this topic is, would you rather have a lot of a little or a little of a lot? What do I mean? Well, here's what I mean, right? If you pick a pepper when it's still green, when it's not fully mature, right? It's been on the vine for potentially half the time or a small percentage of the total time elapsed on the vine. So as the fruit is on the vine, nutrients are flowing into the stem of the fruit. You know, reactions are happening in the fruit. Nutrients are basically building up in the fruit over time. So the sooner you pick it, the less time it's on the vine. It's like, you know, going to the store and buying unripe fruit that doesn't have its full flavor, has not gone to full maturity. So basically, when you're picking an unripe fruit, you might get more quantity, but you're gonna get significantly less nutrition. And you know, I grow a garden because I almost lost my life. I wanna grow the highest quality food, you know, by adding things like trace minerals and organic fertilizers and homemade compost in my soil to have the highest quality food. And I don't wanna shortchange myself by picking my peppers too early. Now there is one exception. The one exception is if I'm gonna get a frost, then everything comes off my pepper plants. And then, you know, generally I give the ones away that aren't fully ripe to friends because I don't like to eat them. That being said, hey, some unripe peppers I grew is probably still better than store-bought conventional peppers, you know, that are being shipped in from far away. So I always want to encourage you guys to do good, better, best, right? As much as I don't harvest green peppers to eat normally, at the end of the season I do. But here's the reason why, the real big reason why, all right? So minerals, they'll increase the longer the plant is on the vine. Furthermore, some of the most important nutrients in the peppers, such as the vitamin C, go up significantly. So vitamin C on a green pepper versus a red pepper, it's 1.5 times higher. So you're getting more nutrition. So even if you get, you know, three times less, you're still getting 1.5 times more vitamin C. Let's not even talk about vitamin A, right? Vitamin A in a ripe pepper compared to an unripe green bell pepper, 8 times higher, right? So now if you just let that one pepper that you would have picked early ripen up, you're getting 8 times the vitamin A, right? Do you want 8 times the nutrition or 8 times less nutrition and have 3 times as much? The math doesn't work out, people. Even if you have 3 times as much, you're gonna have more nutrition if you have ripe fruit and harvest less. You know, there's 11 times more beta carotene in a ripe pepper, red pepper, than a green pepper, right? there's 4.5 times more folate, right? Not folic acid. Folic acid's a man-made substance, but folate, which is, you know, what's in the leaves, and they're also, that folate is also in the fruit, right? This is very important for pregnant women, and just people just do not get enough folate these days. It's a really important nutrient. There's 4 times more vitamin E. Vitamin E, along with vitamin C, are antioxidants. These are the properties in the foods that keep us young, that keep us healthy, that allow our bodies to function and heal and regenerate. Do you want to shortchange yourselves by harvesting your peppers early? But John, I got 3 times of peppers. But you got 4 times less vitamin E. Even if you got 3 times more fruit, you're still getting less nutrition overall. Another very important nutrient that's not often thought about in peppers is essential fats, right? There are omega-3 fatty acids, which people like. I grow purslane, and actually I grew purslane underneath my peppers. Be sure to check a past episode where I talked about this and made a video about growing purslane underneath my peppers so I could literally get 2 crops out of 1 raised bed. Also, the purslane down below, high in omega-3 fatty acids. But people don't realize that, yes, even in the peppers, and even if you don't grow omega-3 rich purslane below it, you know, ripe red peppers compared to green peppers have 3 times more omega-3 fatty acids, making a much better balanced omega-3 food versus omega-6 food. When you're eating green peppers, you're getting significantly higher levels of omega-6 in the terms of ratio and the 3. And I recommend eating a dominant diet in omega-3 foods because so many people, unfortunately, eat too many omega-6 foods. And so, yeah, so that's why I harvest my peppers ripe, because the nutritional qualities are better. Plus, of course, you know, when I just pick them ripe like they are here, just fully red, they come off easier, so I don't have to, like, really tug and pull. And plus, when I eat them, nice and sweet. This is a mild jalapeno. Just ate it. I'm feeling no heat. Now, if I get to some of the seeds and some of that, you know, white pith on the inside, I might get a little bit of heat. But to me, I just eat these as sweet peppers. They've done so well. They've been so abundant this year in my garden. You know, and I guess my second favorite, probably the good standby banana peppers that I like to grow. They're sweet bananas. The majority of the peppers I'm growing this year happen to be sweet peppers. I do have a few hot varieties growing. So now that you guys know this, I would encourage you guys to not harvest your peppers early, because you're gonna get more nutrition and a bigger bang and better flavor for the buck. The other reason why you wanna harvest your peppers later is because if you ever ate a green pepper or a pepper that's not fully developed, you bite into it, it's kind of bitter. These are the alkaloids in the peppers. And you know, some people are very sensitive to alkaloids. That being said, peppers overall in the Solanaceae family of plants have lower alkaloids than tomatoes and potatoes and even eggplants. So they're a much safer food, but let's reduce those alkaloids even further by harvesting your peppers at full ripeness when they go down. And the other reason why to harvest your peppers at full ripeness is if you want to save the seeds. If you guys are harvesting your peppers when they're still green, when they're not fully ripe, the seeds may have not fully developed and may not be viable seeds, so you can't save your seeds. Every pepper I harvest that's ripe, I could always save the seeds if I choose to, so I could grow them next year because I know they are fully developed and are ready to grow. So my final tip on harvesting peppers, besides waiting till they're fully red for many reasons, is as soon as that they go red or fully ripe, depending on what variety pepper you got, they might turn yellow at their end stage or full ripeness, peak ripeness. They might turn orange, they might turn purple. But when they do go ripe is you want to go and you want to just strip them off. So pretty much all these lower peppers have gone ripe, and I've been harvesting them as I need them. But now, because they are all ripe, I'm just going to go ahead and strip this plant of all the ripe peppers. You know, now when I do this, that'll signal the pepper plant to be like, hey, I don't have any ripe peppers on me anymore. I need to create more. And then this will go into production to create more peppers, right? And this might add some time. You know, if you harvest your green peppers, you're harvesting them 10 days, 15, 20 days earlier. And if you're letting them go fully ripe, and that's why I like these smaller peppers, they tend to ripen faster, and I'd rather have a lot of small ripe peppers like these mild jalapenos instead of, you know, a few large bell peppers. And actually, I'm not a big fan of growing bells. But yeah, you want to harvest them as soon as you can. So so what I'm going to do in this episode also is do a full-on pepper harvest of all my peppers and show you guys what I got. But before I do that, I actually want to go ahead and give you guys a tour around my garden of all my different pepper beds and share with you guys some of my thoughts about how they're doing in different situations. All right, so first I thought I'd take you to the side of the garden that I was just on, actually, but show you guys over the top. Actually, I put a shade cloth up, and I've had kind of a, you know, I'm experimenting with shade cloth like half of last year and this year, full season in the summertime. And basically I'm finding things are doing better. You know, things are not getting as sunburnt and they're doing quite well. So I'm, you know, glad to have the shade up. I think it helps out my growing a little bit. Things aren't quite as like feeling the full on heat, but they're still getting plenty of heat and sunlight to grow. This is the original pepper bed I did. It's 4 feet by 16 feet. This was planted the earliest. I planted, or purslane came up as a ground cover earlier in the season. And then later in the season, I basically pulled it out, harvested some of the seeds from the purslane when the peppers actually grew in and got pretty thick. The peppers in this bed, depending on which one you're looking at, maybe 2 feet, pushing 3 feet tall. And then the next bed to plant out was this guy, which I did make a video on. And if you guys look down below here, what you'll see is this one has the mulch, reusable mulch. Normally that's thrown away, and my pepper plants planted out maybe like every 11 or so inches. And then going over to this side, you guys can see this is just the standard bare ground underneath there, and I have, you know, my plants tagged by the tag and what kind they are. So here's some of the peppers here growing. And you know, Las Vegas, 100 plus degree weather, nice hot days, you know, you can grow peppers here. And I will say it is a little bit more challenging than growing them in Northern California where I'm used to. You know, sometimes the fruit's going to be a little bit smaller and plants get a bit stressed out, and when they are, if everything's not quite right, you're not going to get as much fruit. And so I do want to say that, you know, one of the reasons they say for this reflective material is to get less pests. And actually, funny enough, I've actually experienced a little bit more pests on this side. And that may be because of the soil is a bit wet and maybe the peppers like a little bit more dry. So the plants are, once again, a little bit stressed out. But over on this side, I've actually had a little bit less pests without. But if we just kind of look down the row, you guys could see like on this side, the plants are definitely taller and growing in a lot better. But over on this side, you know, the plants are actually in a more of a production stage because they have been in the ground longer. So this, since these were not planted at the same exact time, I can't like say like, oh, this side's totally superior. I mean, the growth is more superior, but because this was planted about a month later, I'm still not seeing quite the fruit development on the side with my, you know, mulch there. Now, I do want to say that both these beds have the AquaJet system in there, and I do want to say that in the middle of this bed, you know, I put 5 rows in each of these beds, and the 2 outer rows on the 2 outsides were growing pretty well. But on both beds, I think actually the middle row had big challenges. I've replaced many plants in these beds that just didn't make it, didn't take. Now they were planted from jumbo 6-packs, so the roots were not fully developed. I did top water for a few days, but when I replanted in the middle row of this bed here, I put in actually a drip tubing right down the middle to just go to the plants so that they wouldn't not get enough water. So I'm thinking the AquaJet is just not sufficient to get to the middle, exact middle of the bed. You guys could see at the end of this bed, you know, once again, one of my other all-star performers this year was the Gypsy Pepper. And the gypsy pepper is interesting, right? It goes from many different colors. So it goes from kind of like a green to kind of like this light yellow. And then it kind of goes to this color here, which is kind of like a yellowish kind of orange. Oh, and then here's another one. Kind of goes yellowish orange, like mostly filling in. And then it kind of goes to this color. It's kind of like mostly orange, but with like a still little bit of yellow in there. And then it goes to like mostly all orange turning to red. And I only harvest the gypsies when they're fully red, and this can take some time. That being said, if you are impatient, hey, if they get kind of like mostly orange turning red, you're probably good to go. But yeah, you know, here's under my canopy here. lots of the peppers that are ripening up. And yeah, I think these are the mild jalapenos over on this side, you know, with the foil reflective. You know, I mean, this plant is just packed with peppers. If you just look really closely, they're the currently light. I think these are the bananas, sweet bananas. It's like so many peppers in here just waiting to ripen up. And not quite yet, because once again, they're a bit far behind. All right, let's go ahead and continue down my pathway. Don't worry, I'll be doing a garden tour, my summer garden tour update pretty soon, show you guys everything I grew. This is another bed that I planted out, actually, right after the first bed, with the reflective material, mulch material, reusable, that I'll be reusing in the winter also to keep my soil warm. This keeps it cool. And this bed's doing pretty well. It's also under a shade cloth. I had it on double shade because I was planting them when it was still pretty hot. And then I took it down to single shade, and I've kind of just left them under shade. I'm considering like taking the shade off these guys because they have kind of acclimated. And once again, you know, I did lose some random plants here and there. I had to go in and replant. Here's one that I got to replant still. But yeah, these guys are growing pretty good. And this year I've had some pretty big challenges with these leaf cutter things. And so I just try to keep spraying them down. But nonetheless, despite the leaf cutters, you know, these guys are still flowering and wanting to produce some fruit for me. And then the final pepper planting that I've had that's probably done the best of this whole side of my garden is actually in the back against this wall here. And this is an area that last year I kind of just used for storage. So I didn't really grow anything here, so it's kind of left fallow. I re-enriched the soil. Planted some stuff in here, planted a lot of peppers, and this is probably my most productive area. So you guys could see, like, you know, here's a whole bunch of peppers. I think these are Sierra Nevada Chilenos, and you know, some of these guys are ripe, so they're red. Sometimes people would harvest them when they're kind of like yellow like that. Once again, I like to wait. And then we got some habaneros planted in here. So if you guys look closely, you know, there's a whole bunch of habanero fruit on there. There's a whole bunch down here. Let's see if I can get them on the camera. Yeah, just waiting to ripen up so that I could harvest them. I think the habaneros are the hottest peppers I'm growing this year. Tried to grow mostly, more mild kinds. But yeah, more peppers. Oh yeah, and then I grew some standard jalapenos that are down here also. And once again, I mean, just because they sell the green ones in the store and that's what you think a jalapeno is, you know, I encourage you guys to wait until they're fully red like this, right? You're gonna get more nutrition, sweeter flavor. It's just better all the way around. But yeah, be sure that once they turn all red and ripe, harvest them all so that you could get a next, you know, growth of ones coming on. And so despite the 100 plus degree weather, you guys could see my plants are still flowering. Now in this bed I planted the peppers, but I also interplanted with some other things. And so mainly I planted this guy right here, the Egyptian spinach. Against the wall I have the longevity spinach growing. And then, also in here, I planted some water spinach that's kind of just coming up in here. But here's another really nice pepper plant. Once again, in an area I never planted before. This thing is just like loaded up with these Sierra Nevada Chilenos. And I want you guys to remember what this plant looks like. You know, on this side, this is with the Aquajet system. It's probably right near a jet that's actually oxygenating the ground. We got some pretty good soil over on this side. This plant's pretty loaded up. A couple, actually, that I have to harvest. Thing I want to do next is actually go to the other side of my garden where I have a circular round raised beds with a drip system with soil that is actually not quite as good. All right, now we're going to go ahead and walk on this side of the garden. Man, I mean, you would never know that it's been 100 degrees every single day, or pretty much 100 degrees, 99, 98 for like the last month or two, because my garden is like overgrown here. I gotta kind of weasel my way through. But anyways, over on this side, oh, and it looks like I might have a water leak somewhere. These are my Chilenos on this side, and these guys are actually pushing 3 feet tall here. They're doing pretty good. Now, the leaves aren't quite as deep green, which kind of concerns me a little bit. There's still like plenty and plenty of flowers on here. And if we look down, I mean, we just see like all the ripe fruit down in here. So, I mean, this is growing pretty good. They're fruiting pretty well, but the plants just aren't quite as green. And, you know, I attribute that to the soil. The soil mixes I got on this side of the yard were basically bag soil mixes that had pretty high sawdust content. And I did get a soil test done. and it showed that I was low in nitrogen, so I started adding some pure protein, and I'll have a video on this upcoming soon. And then over here, this is probably one of the last beds of peppers I planted, and this is planted with some dinosaur kale tree-collared hybrid in the middle. And these guys are still just growing, just coming in, since I planted them probably about a month after the ones you guys just saw. So this is the last bed that I wanted to show you guys. Once again, on this side of the yard, I have the soil that's not as good from the big box store, and the round circular 4 foot raised beds bought at Walmart for $10. And then it's on the drip system that goes off multiple times a day. And this is, or supposed to be, the Sierra Nevada Chilenos. I planted a lot this year. I think I got 6 packs for 99 cents on clearance at the end of the season. But yeah, nonetheless, you know, we still got lots of fruit on some of these plants, and I'm just waiting to harvest these guys until they're fully ripe and they turn color. But nonetheless, you know, despite that, they still have plenty of flowers and are currently in flower stage, and I'm not really too concerned about it. Here's like a little baby pepper just starting to grow. You know, because my first frost date is not until the end of November or early December, you know, I should easily get one more harvest out of these guys besides the fruit that are on there. Now, I haven't pruned these, and if I were to top these, you know, I could likely make a higher production. But, you know, I'm just going to kind of let them grow and see what happens. So the last thing I want to do in this episode is actually just share with you guys some of my quick tips with you guys for growing peppers in the desert. Growing peppers in the desert can be quite challenging with, you know, weather in excess of 100 degrees every day. It's really hot, guys. Seriously, and so dry, the plants could definitely dry out. Some days I'll get some droopy leaves on some of my plants. You know, right now it's happening on the ends that's not under the shade, under this section, you know, that's normally under shade. And so I just deal with it. You know, sometimes the plants will snap out, they'll come back, and sometimes they won't, then I just have to replace them. So I always have spare plants on hand. I got a whole bunch of extra 4-inch peppers growing in my flood table that I've been growing, and they've been progressing pretty nicely. So I would recommend this. Basically, I'd recommend growing under shade. It gives you a little bigger cushion and flexibility so that you can be more successful. Normally, I don't recommend growing under shade for peppers unless you live in a really hot climate where it's 100 plus degree days. If you live in a cooler climate where it has cooler nights, then I would recommend likely growing your peppers in a hoop house, because the peppers, you know, they like the nice warm days. They don't like the cold nights, and that may stunt their growth. So you might want to build some kind of hoop house with the open ends on them, keep them a little bit warmer at the nighttime. I'm sure they'll appreciate, as will the yield. The other thing that I really encourage you guys to do, especially if growing peppers in the desert, is don't just pick, you know, California Wonders. They've done really poorly for me in the desert. Any kind of big bell peppers have not done well. The smaller fruited ones do quite well, and I think I found a new winner with the mild jalapenos. Other ones that have done well for me in the past include the sweet bananas. Those always are good performers here for me. As well as, oh, I think I did like the, they're like cherry bombs, but they're the non-hot version. I think I did that a couple years ago. And then of course, this year also the gypsy peppers. I'm quite amazed that gypsy peppers are really quite a versatile pepper. I think they're an AAS winner, and for a good reason, because they're just good performers overall. Of course, also, you know, I do recommend the AquaJet irrigation. This side of my yard is definitely outperforming my other side, and I do like the AquaJet. I think that gives me a little bit of an advantage by oxygenating the root zone for the microbes as well as for the plants. I'm not a big fan of drip system, and I'm a big fan of getting the good and best soil you guys can, because poor soil could literally ruin your crop. If you have like really small plants that aren't seeming to grow too much, the fruit's immature or really small or not growing, you probably don't have enough nitrogen in your soil. And I ran into that this year with some soil testing I did. Be sure to stay tuned for an upcoming soil test episode where I'll get kind of more into this and how I remedied the problem I was having on that side of the yard when I bought basically bagged crappy soil from the big box store, which is, you know, the first year or two, it probably worked all right. But then after that, just went downhill pretty fast, and I'm finally being able to recover some of my yields and some of the growth on that side of the yard due to the poor soil that I got started with. Anyways, the last part of this episode is I'm going to go ahead and harvest some of my peppers, and we'll come back at you with my pepper haul. But first, I want to show you guys this. So here's a pepper I'm just going to harvest right here real quick. Pull off. This is one of the largest bell peppers I've harvested in my garden here. And this is supposed to be a, check it out. This is supposed to be a purple beauty pepper, but look at this, it's red. I don't know if it ever went purple, but I'm happy that it's red and it's fully ripe and I'm gonna probably be eating it for dinner. So yeah, you always gotta kinda wonder the varieties you get and the plant tags, but as long as I got food to eat from my garden, I'm quite happy. So I just got done picking about 3 pounds of peppers here. And these guys will get used for tonight's dinner, maybe like a pound at least in tonight's dinner. Basically what I like to do is I like to make a nice fresh pepper dressing using my vacuum blender. So I'll put like some mangoes, fresh pepper, and maybe like, you know, the sweet peppers, which most of these are sweet. Although I'll go ahead and then harvest a few hot peppers. Maybe just put like one or two hot peppers in with the sweet pepper, blended mango, and a hot pepper. It makes an amazing dressing that I'll pour over lettuce and leafy greens salad. I'm growing the leafy greens, some of the wild leafy greens right now, and that's how I'm going to eat these guys. If you guys have too many peppers when you pick them, I do encourage you guys to do lactic acid fermentation of them. So this is some I made last year. This is I got some garlic floating around in there, and some other different seasonings. But basically, this is just my peppers from last year. So even off the vine, these guys will last, you know, easily a week in my home, or you could put them in the fridge. I don't like to fridge things unless I absolutely have to. Some of these guys were kind of getting already dehydrated in the sun. If you guys look at this guy, it's like a little bit shriveled up. And this guy I'll be using sooner rather than later. Of course, I could also dehydrate all these and preserve them for later. But my favorite way to preserve them is to lactic acid pickle them, ferment them basically. And these are some of the peppers from last year that I basically just fermented. I don't know if I made a video on this or not. I probably did. But they came out really good. Pickled peppercinis, some of my favorite, with actually ripe peppercinis. When you go by in the store, unfortunately, they're unripe. Now, I did want to let you guys know, if you guys see something like this on your peppers, right? See it on the bottom? It's kind of like looks burnt. Well, actually, what that is, that's actually sunburn. The sun is so intense, so hot here, that if there's not enough foliage or leaves growing around to basically cover your peppers, they can and will get burned. You know, the shade cloth helps with this, but nonetheless, if your pepper gets sunburned like this, you don't have to throw it away, right? That's all right. What I do is I eat these. I just cut off the sunburned part and I eat the rest of the pepper, right? Still good food, and I'm glad I'm able to grow my own peppers here in the Mojave Desert. So I guess that's pretty much the end of this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode, learning about when to harvest your peppers, when they're fully mature, and why, also a little tour of some of the pepper beds that I'm growing this year, be sure to give me a thumbs up. That'll encourage me to make more videos sharing my knowledge and experience of growing peppers with you guys. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes I have coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, be sure to check in the description below. I'll put a few links to some pepper videos that I've grown, that I've made in the past, and how I doubled my pepper production without even pruning. That was a really good episode I made in my California garden. Also, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,200 episodes at this time, teach you guys all aspects on how you guys could grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.